for joining today's session. My name is Mason. Today's topic is going to focus around Moldflow Insight and how we can do some advanced results customization. Here's a brief outline of the topics that I would like to cover today. I'm going to talk briefly about the default results, as well as the difference between creating a new result and just customizing an existing default plot. I've then set up several analyses, namely a cool Fill+Pack+Warp analysis. And then I'm going to go through each analysis sequence, namely the Fill+Pack+Warp or the flow results. I'm going to talk about the cooling results as well as warp results. I'm not going to cover them in each detail. I'm just going to talk about the different ways that I customize plots that stem from that analysis sequence. At the end, we're going to open it up to Q&A. I'm going to start in PowerPoint, but with each topic or section, I'm going to jump into Moldflow Insight to give a brief demonstration of the topic at hand. Just a brief background about myself. Again, my name is Mason. I am a principal implementation consultant within Autodesk, and I've been with Autodesk for almost 5 years now. I am a certified Moldflow expert. I do training and consulting around the Moldflow product lines, and I'm based here in Erie, Pennsylvania. So I'm going to talk briefly about the default results and why they are the default for a reason before we get into the customization and creation topics. So before we get into the presentation, I would like to stress that anytime we run a Moldflow analysis, it's important to understand why are you running this Moldflow analysis, or what objective do you have? As you can see here, everything on this list are great questions. They can all be answered by running a Moldflow analysis, but it can be beneficial to group these into different subgroups. So for example, where should the gates be and how many gates are required? That's a great question that could be answered with the potential gate location analysis. Will the part fill? Are there air traps? Are there weld lines? That could be answered from a filling analysis. Can the part be packed enough? That's a packing related question. Is the cooling uniform? Will the warp be within tolerance? Obviously, those would be cooling and warp related questions. So all good questions, but it can be beneficial to group these questions into like-minded categories based on analysis sequence. So when we're doing these results interpretation or customization, we're going to be looking at these different groups of plots. So you can see that I have listed here all of the analyses, or excuse me, all the plots that are generated when we run a cool Fill+Pack+Warp with either a dual domain mesh type or a cool Fill+Pack+Warp with the 3D mesh type. So you can see the flow results are listed for both dual domain and 3D. Then we have obviously our cool and warp results. Subject to change ever so slightly when we're talking about cooling, whether we're doing boundary element method or finite element method. Same thing with your warp. If you isolate cause of warp, you might get slightly different or additional plots as I have listed here. But these are the plots that would come stock when you run these analysis sequences. All good information. I would encourage you to review and evaluate these plots in their own right. What we're trying to do with today's session is to get you to look at these plots in a new manner and or create new plots that help you answer your objective in a timely manner. So customizing plots, kind of a first pass here. The plot that I'm showing on the left is the stock fill time plot. By default, it's set to shaded unless you have changed your preferences. And you can see the color segments go from a shaded distribution from one color to the next. If we go into our plot properties and change that to be a contour, what you can see is these ISO lines now give us a different view of what's potentially really happening. So if we have concerns about hesitation or race tracking, this view of the fill time plot gives a completely different evaluation in that these ISO lines, when they're close together, that could be a sign of hesitation. If we have wide distributions between ISO lines, that's an indication that we might have potential race tracking, depending on where it's observed in the part. That type of race tracking and hesitation was very difficult to observe with the default shaded view. Anytime you're in Moldflow Insight, you can right click on the plot and go to plot properties from the environment toolbar. And you can see that we have a list of plot properties that you can alter for each plot. We can do things like shaded and contour as we just saw in the fill time plot. We can adjust the animation, scaling, the display, as well as the color segments, smooth, banded, single color. So personal preference here, just know that we're going to be playing in this space a little bit when we go through these different customization techniques. You can also create new plots. So you can right click on your results and go to new plot, or again, from the results panel, you can click new plot custom. And that will bring up this create new plot context menu where you can select the plot that you would like to create, as well as the plot type that you would like to create from that available result. One thing I would like to point out is the number of intermediate results or intermediate intervals with the 3D mesh type can be a little bit coarse. By default, it's set to calculate 5 calculations during filling, 5 during packing, and 3 during cooling. As you can see here, I've gone into the advanced options, solver parameters, edit intermediate results, edit intervals, and I've increased that to 20, 20, and 20. This is just going to give me additional calculations for the filling, packing, and cooling phase when we look at these plots. Just a good best practice that I recommend. I do have some customers that go all the way up to 50, 50, and 50. I do feel like this is slightly overkill because the more timestamps you put here, the longer it's going to take for the analysis to solve. So I feel like 20 is a nice balance between speed and accuracy. Actually going to jump into software here just to kind of show some of the things that we reviewed in PowerPoint. So the first thing we talked about was the fill time plot. As I mentioned, you can animate this through time in the default shaded view. That is completely acceptable. But something like right-click plot properties, we can go from the default shaded to that of a contour. And that could be ideal, again, for identifying things like race tracking and hesitation. So a little bit of a personal preference here, but again, it's a different way to look at kind of the standard fill time plot. Again, if we go back to this and just right-click plot properties, we can also do that from the results tab as well. But here you can see that we have different avenues in terms of methods, animation, scaling, display, and then some optional settings, which we'll get into a little bit. But we're going to be using this tool frequently when we're customizing plots. As I mentioned, we can also create a new plot. We can do this also from the results panel. We can just click this drop down and we can create a new plot. Or we can right click on our results here and click new plot. And that brings up this create new plot menu, which we'll also be using frequently. One final piece of information, as I mentioned, under the 3D intermediate results, I've gone into my advanced options, solver parameters, edit intervals. You can see in this case, it is set to the default 5, 5, and 3. We would want to change that to 20, 20, and 20 for our next analysis to make sure that we get enough calculations in that area. Instead of doing that on every single time we run a 3D analysis, you can also go up to the tools, databases, edit default properties, and you can go in and change your thermoplastic injection molding defaults for 3D. You can simply edit those here, and you can see that that would run in, you basically set it once, and you would override your defaults. All right, so taking a first step at this particular topic, we're gonna talk about Fill+Pack+Warp or flow results. I feel this is a good starting point. If you follow our Moldflow methodology or the Moldflow design principles, one of the first analyses that we're going to be running is usually a filling analysis followed eventually by a fill plus pack analysis. So I feel like that was a decent starting point for today's session. So the first plot I would like to talk about is the velocity plot. So you can see by default, if we look at the default scale on the velocity plot for this 1+1 family mold, it looks a little bit uneventful. Everything is basically a single color. It looks like there's dots or maybe they're tensors. I can't really see what's going on there. Even when we animate this, we might get a little bit of resolution at the gate, but doesn't really tell me a whole lot of what's going on. If we were to adjust that and reduce the scale to a maximum of 50, just arbitrary, just a lower value. If you can see from the previous example, the default velocity was about 2,500 centimeters per second. We're reducing the max in this case to around 50, maybe 100. In this case, you can see that just that simple change in scaling, instead of watering down everything, you can see that it gives you an idea of where the velocity changes are occurring inside the model in a much easier manner. I guess you could make the case that you could also go to right-click properties and just do specified per frame. Would achieve a similar result in this particular case. But again, something simple as scaling the velocity results gives you a lot more information in terms of how the material is actually flowing in this particular part. Let's actually just, while we have that part open, let's just go to that particular results, namely the velocity plot here. And let's turn on the other part as well. So again, the default view for the velocity plot, if we animate this through time, it again, single color doesn't really tell me a whole lot about what's going on. Simple change, we can go right here from the results panel and just reduce the maximum to say 50 as we talked about in PowerPoint. And again, this really gives us a unique feel for what is truly going on within this part, just by simply changing the scale. So using this scale can be a useful feature depending on what we're looking at, velocity versus volumetric shrinkage, shear rate, for example. And you can see that we can just hit set scale or reset scale depending on what we want to do. One thing that I think is... it comes up a lot during our training courses is clamp force predictions. First and foremost, right, Moldflow Insight 101, you want to make sure that your model is oriented in the proper Moldflow position. So we want the mold open or the sprue position or die draw, whatever you want to call it, to be in the positive Z direction. So we want the XY plane to be parting plane essentially, because that's what we're using for our clamp force calculations. If the model is not oriented properly, we're not assuming the correct projected area, therefore clamp results will be incorrect. So you can see, I know it's difficult to see here, but I'll open up this model as well. I have a very simple tray that is in the correct mold flow position, as well as one that's orientated 90 degrees that is in the incorrect mold flow position. At the first pass of looking at the clamp force XY plot, it looks like we have a similar trend, but if we take a look at the tonnage over time, in particular the tonnage, you can see on the corrected plot we have about 27 tons, where on the incorrect one we're just about 3 tons. So obviously the model orientation is going to heavily influence clamp force. Anytime you're comparing plots like I'm doing here, it could be advantageous to make sure that they're on the same scale. So by default, it gives you an automatic scale. But again, when I'm comparing to, I want to use the same scale. So I've taken that second plot on the right there and adjusted the scale to be that of the plot on the left, just so we get a true depiction, a true comparison between those two plots. If you do run into a situation where you did not orient the model correctly, now would be a great time to use the new plot custom clamp force on parting plane. And you can adjust your parting plane normal direction based on the correct vector there. And it will generate a new plot for you with the correct clamp force on parting plane. So this will save you from having to rerun the analysis. I probably would encourage that you do rerun the analysis, but if it's late on a Friday afternoon, this would be a nice way to double check the clamp force prediction by creating a new plot. So again, this is the two examples that I showed before. The model on the left is the correct orientation. The model on the right is the incorrect clamp force XY plot. First pass, again, it is difficult to look and see that this one is incorrect unless we pay close attention to the scale. Again, if we're comparing these two plots, what I would typically recommend is that you come in here to the second one and just modify this under plot properties. On the Y range, you can see I can set this to be that of manual and set the max to be replicate of the first plot there. And when I do so, you can see that the comparison gets a little bit more even when we use the same scale. This is not a Moldflow thing, right? This is kind of Excel 101. If we stick with the incorrect one, as I mentioned, we can come up to the results new plot because again, this one, it does not have the correct Moldflow position. If we're in a hurry, we can go to new plot, custom clamp force on parting plane. And we can create a new plot that has a different normal direction based on the one that we ran. And then it will actually generate a new plot in our study tasks that we can then evaluate. So again, I would encourage to rerun the analysis, but this is a way to generate the data without having to rerun. So kind of sticking with the other part that I plan on showing today, as you can see from this particular controller, weld lines are a plot that I would encourage you to evaluate. The stock view to look at weld lines would be the weld line degree of formation. So even though that says degree, that is not a temperature, that is actually a degree of formation on how the weld line would form. Anything that's blue or a lower value is a weak butt weld. Anything in red is more of a meld line and would have a potential stronger area than a weaker butt weld. But one thing, again, the default view in its own right is valuable to me. But what you can do is if you go into plot properties and go to the highlight tab, you can actually change the weld lines to kind of map the weld lines by other properties, if that makes sense. So in this particular case, I'm looking at the weld lines, but I'm also showing the pressure at end of fill in those weld line areas. So now I'm getting a pressure at the weld. In this particular case, something with a higher pressure could have a higher strength in that weld line area. Same thing, we can do temperature at flow front. So in this particular case, while I'm still looking at the weld line, I'm actually now looking at the temperature of the material that forms the weld. In this case, something with a hotter melt could have a potential stronger weld line as opposed to something that has a cooler melt that forms that weld line. So just a really quick way to kind of get beyond the stock view of looking at weld lines and using some of these different highlight features. So again, looking at weld lines in its own right is important, I would say. But if you wanted to customize this weld line plot, again, you can right click on weld lines and go to plot properties, in particular this highlight tab, and then click on this small radio icon. And we can change that to be any of these plots that we would want to utilize. So in this particular case, I'm just going to show you temperature at flow front. And then you can see that the weld line will ultimately change up here, highlighting the fact that while we are still showing you the weld line, this is actually the temperature of the weld. So very quick and easy way that we can look at additional data points around our weld lines. again, don't discredit the default plots with a 3D mesh type. We actually generate a couple additional weldline plots, namely the surface movement and surface formation plots. Equal in their own right, they are very useful pieces of information that I encourage you to look at as well. One of my colleagues, Matt Jaworski, actually created some customized weldline scripts that I've actually run here. So we can actually look at things like the melt mobility of a weld line, as well as the pressure and temperature of the weld as well. So if you're interested in using this script on a 3D part, just let me know after the session today. Shoot me an email and I can share that script that you can run as well. Overlay, this one's pretty straightforward, I think. You can overlay two plots to help, again, kind of stress the point that you're trying to make when you're sharing results with someone that may not be as well-versed with Moldflow as you may be. In this particular case, the second plot that you right-click and hit overlay on is the one that you can actually control or animate. So in this particular case, I've changed the weld lines to be a single color, namely pink, and I've overlaid the fill time plot that I can then animate through time to see how those weld lines ultimately, or how those filling patterns ultimately form those weld lines. So I'll actually show you that real quick because it's pretty easy. First step is to go to the weld line plot, and we're actually going to go back to the default weld line view. So this is just getting it back to the degree of formation. Under optional settings, I usually set it to be a single color. Pink is pretty obvious to me, so it shows well. So once we have the weld lines set to be single color, we can go back to fill time, right click, and hit overlay. This will allow the weld lines to stay in place, but then we can animate the fill time. Let's go ahead and change that one back to shaded as well. And now when we animate this through time, we can actually zoom up and see that obviously these two flow fronts coming together are creating this particular weld line. I usually try to cap this at two plots. Even though you can do additional ones, the data can get very messy when you start combining more than two plots, in my opinion. Another 3D plot that's specific to obviously a 3D mesh would be changing the temperature plot to be a single contour, and that single contour being set to a transition temperature. This will allow you to determine things like gate seal time, which can be used as an input for our pack time, because once the gate is sealed, obviously we're not packing any additional material into the part cavity. So since we are in a 3D mesh type, if we go to temperature, it looks a little anticlimactic because everything is basically my mold temperature. Now, same rules apply, right? If you wanted to evaluate temperature, you can do a cut plane to kind of see inside the model. But for this particular case, I'm actually going to turn my runner layer on. And then before we get into this, we actually have to go back to our materials and go right click on the details page to generate some of this information. So the first thing that I'm going to write down is the ejection temperature for this material. Each material has its own tested ejection temperature, as well as the transition temperature under the rheological properties tab. So I'm just going to write down both of these values, because we're going to use those in the creation of our next plot. So I can either right-click and modify the properties for this plot, but let's do something different. Let's go up to our flow results and let's create a new plot. So I'm just going to right-click and say new plot, and then go to temperature animation plot. That's going to create a copy of our temperature plot, and I'm just going to rename this gate seal. If I go to properties of this, I'm actually going to set it to contour, single contour. In this particular case, I'm going to set it to the transition temperature if I want to set, if I want to identify the gate seal time. I would then want to kind of zoom up to this gate area because if we're trying to determine gate seal time, we want to be focusing on that area. So I'm going to try to zoom in here and just animate this through time. So anything in blue is still molten at this point because of the nature of the transition temperature. So you can see that at timestamp, basically 5 seconds, this is all the material that's still molten. Why this is important is because this is all the material that we're still able to pack at timestamp 5 seconds. At timestamp 7 seconds, thereabouts, you can see that we still have a lot of material that is still above the transition temperature, but this small island near the gate is really the only thing that we're packing because it's the only material that's connected to the gate. If we take another time, look at a couple other timestamps, basically by 10 seconds, this gate is completely solidified. You could make the case that, you know, 8-9 seconds, you're packing this small amount of material, but in between 9 to 10 seconds is when that gate seal has occurred. So I would then need to modify that from my by subtracting my fill time. That now becomes my new pack time that I would set in my next fill plus pack analysis. We can do the same thing. Obviously, this is using the transition temperature to help determine when the gate seals off. We can also use a temperature single contour set to the ejection temperature to see when we should eject that material or that part from the mold as well. Same workflow, just the plot's going to tell us a different output. Time to reach ejection temperature would be a very similar plot to evaluate as a single contour temperature set to the ejection temperature. One thing that would be important is that when we look at these results, regardless of time to reach ejection temperature, this is kind of a holistic Moldflow Insight principle. When you have multiple layers on, so if you have your parts and your runners on different layers, when you look at a plot, oftentimes the plot will be scaled to what's visible. So in this first case on the left, I have my time to reach ejection temperature with my runner and parts layers on. And it's saying that I need about 120 seconds required to cool the runner and part. If I turn the runner off and just look at the parts, you can see that it's only taking about 37 seconds for me to cool down the part cavities. So obviously the runner should not be dictating our cycle time in terms of cooling. So just know that depending on what layers you have on are going to influence these results and may give you different answers that we need to evaluate or interpret correctly. All right, I'm going to change gears a little bit and talk about cooling related plots. While I do make a lot of modifications on my fill plus pack or my flow results, as well as my warp, I tend not to modify my cooling results as much, but I did want to highlight a couple times that I do modify these plots. The first one is kind of like we looked at with the flow results. We generate a velocity plot when we run a cool FEM and have 3D channel Tetras. Kind of like the initial velocity plot, when you look at the spectrum of velocity, in this case on the left, from 0 to basically 100 centimeters per second, you kind of lose some resolution. You don't really know what's happening. If we actually increase this velocity from the bottom up, namely set the lower end to be something a middle range, that kind of allows us to see the true path that the water is ultimately taking. This could be very useful for us when we design 3D conformal cooling channels, because anything where we don't see tensors in this case is basically a dead flow area that's not really cooling our mold effectively. So again, we can use this to refine our cooling channel designs. I'm actually going to change gears on you and look at a very similar model that I have set up. In this particular case, I've set up a cool FEM fill pack warp because I have the 3D 3D tetra cooling channels. So again, when we look at the velocity plot, it can be a little misleading as to what's going on here. I'm actually going to turn off my mold tetras just so we can get a better view of what's going on in this particular case. Again, when you're looking at different things, in this particular case for velocity channel 3D, you want to make sure that you have your channel tetras on as well. But you can see the stock velocity plot kind of is difficult to see exactly those high flow areas. If we go to the results page and then set the scale, in this case, we're going to increase the minimum to be something like 43. Centimeters per second. And again, it's just going to kind of streamline exactly the path that the water is taking to allow us to modify or iterate on this cooling channel design to avoid those dead flow areas and get us a better cooling 3D conformal cooling channel design. So pretty easy scaling, but again, a little bit different than the flow scaling that we did when we actually decreased the maximum. In this case, with the cooling channels, we're actually increasing the minimum. And then because I ran a cool FEM, one of the cool plots that we can definitely evaluate is the temperature mold transient. Obviously, we would need a 3D mold block in this particular case, but because of that, it can be difficult for us to identify hotspots in our mold. Because it's a 3D mold, you know, we would have to do something like a cut plane or maybe a probe plot to try to see inside the model. All good avenues. But when I was working to create this presentation, I was working with my colleague, Tim Van Est, and we actually kind of stumbled upon a new way to look at temperature mold that I thought was pretty interesting. So I'll share that with you. But again, cool FEM, you can still use the cut planes, that's fine. But what we've kind of created, I guess you could say, would be to set the scale on this to be a specified scale. And we're only trying to look at the hotspots. So we've kind of increased the minimum from ambient up to about 100 C. We've ensured that the deselect extended color is option is selected, and then we've set the surface display to be transparent. Now, this does give you a similar look and feel to another plot that's generated from a cool FEM, but if you're trying to identify the hotspot, if that's the objective, this is a very nice way to see inside the model on where the hotspots ultimately are, so we can ensure that we get either advanced cooling in there, maybe a mold insert perhaps. So I found that this was a useful way to look at the temperature mold transient result. So if we go back to Moldflow Insight and go to the temperature mold transient, again, like anything else, you'd want to make sure that your mold tetras are turned on in this particular case. Obviously, since we have a transient analysis, it would make sense to animate this over time. But again, the stock view is a little bit obstructed in terms of the size of the model is actually prohibiting me from seeing inside it. So in this case, I would want to go to View, Edit, and add a cut plane in this case. And I'm just going to do a ZY in this particular case. You can also exit the cut planes from the results tab as well. Just a personal preference that I always go to view. Again, you can animate this and now we can kind of get some additional highlights. We can actually see the mold cavity heating up during the filling and then ultimately cooling down during the packing and cooling phase. All good data, but we kind of have to, you know, investigate or maybe move this cut plane to see exactly where the hotspots ultimately reside. So another way that we can do this is I'm actually going to turn this cut plane off. I'm going to go to plot properties. I'm going to go to scaling, and go to specified. And I'm just going to look at the hotter spectrum of that particular area. So anything that's above 100 degrees Celsius. And I'm going to set my surface display to be that of transparent. So instead of trying to use cut planes and identify exactly where the hotspots are, I can now animate this through time and see exactly where those hotspots reside and at which area during the cycle that they ultimately occur. So you can see that instead of trying to use cut planes or a probe plot, this is a very fast and easy way that we can look at these particular results, identify the hotspots, and make changes based on this data. So rounding off the presentation, I do want to talk about warp results. As I mentioned previously, deflection is very commonly used piece of information from Moldflow Insight. There's a lot of things that we can do with deflection results that I feel like we should talk about. So we're going to go through kind of the standard way to look at deflection results, as well as how we can modify some of these plots. As I mentioned before, scaling by layer is critical. Just like time to reach ejection temperature, when you're looking at deflection, it also will scale by layers. So in this case, on my 1+1 family mold, when I have both cavities visible, it's showing me the deflection all effects for both cavities. If I turn one cavity off and just look at the other, it's going to update the scale according to what's visible on my screen, namely the deflection for the one side of the part of my family mold. Again, as we talked about, the deflection all effects, that's kind of the standard way to look or evaluate warp. Nothing wrong with this particular way. I just want to talk about some methods that we can use to help modify or answer that question in a faster manner. So by all means, I still look at the deflection all effects. It's a great way to get a feel for how the part is warping. So this is good in its own right. I constantly evaluate this plot. When we talk about Insight training, when we come to this particular section, anchor points and anchor planes tend to be very commonly discussed. Unfortunately, they're not used as frequently in the industry. What an anchor point or anchor plane does, an anchor point would just be a single point that we place on the model, namely that center point that you can see there. And that will kind of re-zero the deflection results based on that new point. It's kind of like re-zeroing or setting that's my home position on my CMM, if you will. And all the results or all the deflection results are going to be based off of that new point. If you select three of these anchor points, you've actually defined a plane that you can now measure against. A good reference on when to use anchor points and anchor planes is if you know how the quality department is going to ultimately measure or fixate this part into your measurement device. So if they're grabbing the part about one or two areas, you'd want to put points on there that mimic that measurement technique. So when we update these deflection plots, they're representative of how we're fixturing it in both in Moldflow Insight as well as in our test fixture. Again, there's no wrong way to look at deflection, either best fit or with anchor planes. Typically, I would apply anchor points or anchor planes when that area or that fixation point is provided to me. I'm going to switch models on you one last time and just look at deflection all effects in this particular case. Again, please pay attention when I turn off the one cavity here on my model. It's actually going to update my deflection results to be that of just the one part. So you can see that this is now showing me the deflection. I'm actually going to turn my runner off as well. This is just showing me the deflection that's corresponding to this particular part. In this particular case, this is the best fit. It's allowing the part to shrink and warp basically towards the centroid. Let me just make sure that I have it. Okay, so I do have an LCS here that we'll talk about in a little bit, but it is not activated. In this particular case, this is the best fit. Let me just ensure that that is a correct statement here. Again, the best fit is allowing it to shrink and warp towards the centroid of the model. Let me just, okay. So you can see that under the deflection tab, I am looking at XYZ. It is a global Cartesian, and we're looking at magnitude. If you wanted to come up here and visualize, we can add a new anchor plane. Again, the first point we select on our anchor is going to re-zero the model. So you can see that it basically changed how the model is now oriented in the mold. And it's basically any area around that is showing very low deflection because it's kind of snapping it back to its nominal CAD. Again, wherever your quality department is taking measurements on this particular part, you would want to try to replicate that with multiple points. And you can see that that is going to influence or change our deflection on how we anchor that or fixate the part. So very, very powerful tool, very useful tool that we can use depending on how we measure the deflection of these plastic parts. So one thing that quite honestly confused me, especially when I was going through my expert certification, I believe I lost some points because I didn't fully understand this particular component of taking radial deflection measurements. We can change how we look at these deflection results. If we have a cylindrical feature or a cylindrical part, obviously we may not want to look at the Cartesian magnitude. We may want to look at a cylindrical coordinate system in a radial component. So again, multiple ways that we can look at deflection. In this case, I'm going to walk you through how to look at a radial deflection. While we're on here, so a couple items. You can see that I have an LCS or a local coordinate system. This is something that you would want to have in place before you try to modify your deflection result. Ideally, we would want to have this in place before you run the analysis, but there are ways that you can create these LCSs after simulating. But before can definitely be easier. So we want to make sure we have a node there with an LCS. We want to make sure that that LCS is activated. And then we would just come in here and then switch that to be the coordinate system from Cartesian to be that of cylindrical. And then magnitude, we would also change that to be radial component. One other step that, again, kind of confused me initially is we need to go into our warpage visualization. And instead of using the best fit about all nodes, we need to modify the best fit to be something around the circumference of the feature that we want to measure, whether that's the part or the feature itself. And we want to do a best fit about that node list so we get a true depiction of the radial deflection. I'll show you what that looks like because, again, it kind of confused me a little bit. So the first thing I'm going to do is turn on my LCS, and then I'm going to make sure that that particular LCS is activated before we go on to this next step. So you can see that went from maroon to red. That's an indication that it is now activated. But the plot really didn't change that much. So if I go into plot properties, deflection, this is where we can change this to be that of cylindrical, as well as I can ensure that that LCS or local coordinate system is actually highlighted, and then hit apply. Still not exactly what we are looking for. You can see that things changed a little bit, things shifted, but it's really not, centroid about that LCS. We need to go into our visualization tools and go to best fit. And then here we need to select a node list around the circumference of that particular part. We can grab the ID, the OD, doesn't really matter. I just need a node list that's around kind of that feature, if you will. So I'm going to go to mesh, and I actually have one of these saved for me. Let's see, I'm just not what I wanted to do. Let me try that again. So let's make sure that my nodes are turned on. I can just grab a node and then go to nodes on the same edge. That's going to select all the nodes around the OD of this particular cylinder that are on that same edge. Depending on the model size, the mesh count, the mesh element count, this can take a couple seconds for it to populate, but you'll see it is a very useful tool that allows me to select multiple nodes in a timely manner, as opposed to trying to pick them manually one by one. It doesn't have to be, obviously for this particular scenario, I do want to grab nodes on the same edge. You may have seen from that previous selection tool, we can do a lot of different things. I can grab elements on the same surface, nodes on the same surface. So a lot of different selection tools available there. So I'm just going to save this particular one. We actually might come back to this and use this one. So while it's there, I'm actually going to copy this as well. If we go back to deflection, all effects, radial component. Results, visualize, best fits, and paste these nodes in there. It's going to change things the way, it's going to change how this model ultimately looks. And now it's giving me a radial component about that particular centroid. Another thing that we can do in this particular case is actually take that a step further. Because we have that node list selected, we can actually grab a deflection all effects path plot. And this is just looking at the deflection of those particular nodes around that OD of my particular controller in this case. Again, it's just a different way to look at deflection. Again, I'm just looking at the node lists around the OD, but when you overlay that with a deflection all effects radial component, it can give you an idea for how much concentricity variation you have in that particular part. Case in point, you can see that I've just created a new deflection all effects path plot, and I've put in those node IDs from the previous OD selection there. And I've also overlaid that from the radial component that we just looked at. Again, it's a way that we can look at the distance those nodes are deforming from the LCS as well as the material process inputs that we use for our deflection result. Another thing that I feel like are somewhat hidden items is that there's some embedded scripts that come within the software that can be useful when we're looking at things like deflection. You can see that I've done something similar here where I've grabbed the previous node list that we used for the best fit node selection in the previous example, and I've just opened up the command line and typed roundness. That is going to give you the concentricity both before and after deflection on the node list that you have selected. Obviously, if concentricity is your goal, you can type in roundness. We also have one that's available for flatness as well if you're trying to look at or evaluate flatness. So in this particular case, I'm just going to look at the, now I'm going to get it back to the nominal. So I'm going to turn off my LCS here. Hide that. If we go back to properties, deflection, I'm just going to get this back to Cartesian magnitude. Again, if we go up to our user interface and then just open up the command line, a couple things we can do. You can just type in help. Now, your list may look slightly different than mine, but when you type in help from the command line, this is going to give you all the scripts that are contained within your script folder that comes with the software. So some of these are stock that come with the software. Most of these have been added by me personally over time. So something like flatness, for example, is something that comes with the software. You can see that the flatness command calculates the flatness after warp of the selected nodes. Similar to that, we also have one that comes preloaded, which would be roundness. So again, that one's going to calculate the roundness and concentricity of the node list before and after warp. So the first thing that we need to do here is I'm going to actually go to mesh and I'm going to grab those roundness nodes. So again, you need to grab those nodes. You do have to run a deflection analysis or a warp analysis for this to work as well. But if we go back to user interface command line and then just type in roundness, you got to spell it right too. It's going to generate this roundness plot for you, both before and after concentricity. So if your objective is to try to determine concentricity after deflection analysis, this would be a very fast tool that you can do to help calculate concentricity. Again, we can do the same thing with the radial deflection plots or the radial path plots. It's just the roundness script that comes is a lot easier to use as opposed to all that plot manipulation. All right, so where do we go from here? So hopefully you've determined that there's multiple ways that we can look at similar results. I would just encourage you that if you've seen anything that I've done here that helps you answer your question in a faster time, then I would encourage you to use it. The method that works for you might be different than the method that works for your colleagues. So again, it's a personal preference here. I would just encourage you to use the methods that work best for you and your customers if you're a consultant that are sharing results. One thing that I do have listed here is, you know, the analysts that are running these analyses, I'd assume that is a large portion of the audience today, right? We're not mind readers. So we have to really ensure that our customers or whoever we're sharing the results with understand the capabilities of the tool. If there's a plot that they want to have included, right? As analysts, we either need to know that up front or, you know, cover our basis and just give an immense amount of data. So just want to make sure we have those discussions with whoever are ultimately reviewing these results as to if they see one of these plots that are not stock or default, we need to ensure that as analysts that we include those in our reports or our Moldflow communicator files. And then really just try new things. Like I said, Tim and I, when we were creating this presentation, you know, we kind of stumbled upon that mold temperature plot. So I would just encourage you to try some of these customization tools or creating new plots to help you answer that Moldflow question, which is the whole reason why you're running your analysis. With that, I'd like to thank you for your time and open it up to any questions or I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.